Welcome to Traveling Epic with Joel 365 Podcast. Turn up the volume and tune in for another episode of your favorite technology traveler and storyteller. You're listening to Traveling Epic with Joel 365 Podcast. And now, your host, Joel 365.
Let me tell you why Ethiopia is one of the most magical and interesting places I've ever been. It's the diversity of experiences you can have in Ethiopia. From tracking down the Ark of the Covenant, to visiting the largest rock-hewn churches in the world, to visiting African Camelot. No, seriously, incredible castles, as amazing as they are in Europe, to seeing primitive man, where Lucy, our most ancient ancestor, can be connected to visiting the tribes of the Omo Valley, where you have the lit puck, colored paint, and incredible stories of tribes that live in mud huts, beehive houses, straw little houses. It's incredible. Maybe you're interested in Rastafarianism and where that came from. This is the source, the heart of Africa, with incredible religious mysteries that seem to take us back to Ethiopia for answers to life's deepest mysteries. The source of the Nile to how life began. Ethiopia. Wow. What an incredible place. So much diversity. It's just incredible. You know, the name Ethiopia invokes ideas of poverty and despair and starvation, popularized by the vast famine in the 80s, and all the crazy work that was done to raise money. It wasn't just a famine, it was actually a political situation, and I don't want to spend time digging into that. But suffice to say, it was a massive tragedy for such a lush, beautiful, incredible country with some of the most diverse, greatest diversity on the planet. In my last video, I told you about how Papua New Guinea has some of the most diversity in languages on the planet. Ethiopia is right there as well. Pockets of tribes, many languages and cultures that stretch back thousands of years. It has one of the longest Christian and Jewish traditions on the planet. It stretches back all the way to the apostles of Jesus. And many of the Jewish traditions in the country stretch back even further. There's people who talk about the time of Moses being, and him spending some time in Ethiopia, or the stories about Solomon and the Queen of Sheba, and how the Queen of Sheba was actually from Ethiopia. There's so many fantastic stories, and the big one, the Ark of the Covenant, the most prized possession, the most prized offering from God on the planet, you know, both in Christian and Judaism. That's probably the pinnacle if you were to talk about something that comes from God or interacts with God, holding the commandments. Incredible. And you talk about that actually being preserved in Ethiopia. Yeah, there's stories in Aksum. We're gonna start out our story in Aksum, where the Ark was eventually brought back from Jerusalem, where King David had brought it. The city was destroyed by the Babylonians in 587. The next city I want to tell you about is Gondar. It's often called the Camelot of Africa. And even that description doesn't do it the royal service, because Camelot is a legend, whereas Gondar is reality. If you think about it, this is castles in Africa. It's kind of mind-blowing, but it tells you about the history and just how rich it is in Ethiopia. People have no idea that this stuff actually exists and that there was a massive empire. So let me tell you quick about one little excursion we took where we went to Deber Daimo Monastery. in an isolated mountain, northern part of Tigray. It's unique compared with most Ethiopian monasteries. It was built in the 6th century. It has an extensive collection of priceless manuscripts that have remained intact until today. Many books have been written there and distributed to churches throughout Ethiopia. And we ended up climbing up a strange skin rope up to the monastery. And the monastery itself at the top of this mountain does not allow women. So only men could come to this place. Even female animals are forbidden to set foot in this monastery. And we must remain under the cliffs and pray from there. Lalibela, Ethiopia. Wow. Ethiopia, famous for its rock-hewn, rock-cut monolithic churches. You know, the whole of Lalibela is large antiquity of the medieval and post-medieval civilization of Ethiopia. And Lalibela is one of Ethiopia's holiest cities, second only to Aksum, where the Ark of the Covenant is. And it's also a center of pilgrimage. Ethiopia was actually one of the earliest nations to adopt Christianity in the first half of the 4th century, and its historical roots date to the time of the apostles. The churches themselves date to the 7th to the 13th century, and traditionally dated to the reign of King Lalibela, around 1181, 1221. But let me tell you, Lalibela to me was actually where I connected with the country. It was actually my first stop on my first trip. I had heard about orphanages in Ethiopia, and I figured that was something what I wanted to connect with Ethiopia, was really helping out an orphanage. Well, little did I realize when I actually visited the orphanage books, I went to the local bookstore, which is basically a hut. And we ended up buying all of the notebooks that they had. And we tried to find a way to distribute them evenly, but it was a madhouse. The kids were so interested in having notebooks because, you know, education is actually something that they sacrifice for. It means so much to them. And it was very difficult to see, but man, it felt so good to be able to help. You have no idea. Now, last of all, let me tell you about the Omo Valley. This is the tribal region. There's about 8 different tribes who live there. The Bodhi, Mercy, Suri or Surma, Hammer, Chai, Suri, Turkana. The lower Omo Valley, spectacular, beautiful area with diverse ecosystems, vast grasslands, volcanic outcrops, that amazing river that really gives life to so much, and with the dam that's really uprooted the life for the tribes out there. And there's still a lot going on even in the future that can disrupt the tribes, and it's important that people understand the impact to the tribes. Now, the Mercy are an ethnic tribe who do agricultural, and they even take care of cows. The Surma tribe will fight to the death to protect their herd, or even risk their lives. The Surma are well known for their large clay plates that the women wear in their lower lips. There's the decorative scarification, and you'll see the white paint or the white clay on their bodies as well. And children are known to decorate themselves with flowers, blossoms, green plants around the villages. It's such an incredibly beautiful thing to see, just connecting with nature, connecting with the people from who've been, these traditions go back thousands of years, and really connect us back to the beginning. I mean, it's incredible. And I really don't want to lose this. I mean, it's really important for us to understand. And in a lot of ways, I feel like these are the people who can tell us a lot about where we came from.
Your contributions make this show possible. Thanks to our sponsor. Subscribe to the podcast on all streaming platforms. If you found value in this show, leave us a review or simply share with a friend. Also, make sure to visit our website, travelingepic.com. Subscribe to exclusives on Patreon or sponsor an upcoming episode. Thanks for joining us this week on Traveling Epic with Joel 365.
Attending them.
That's the meal.
Come on.
Oh, I see.